Thank you. If there's another academia-oriented question, we'll have Dean Room do the next one, all right?
Hi, I'm Ellen Schmidt. I work at the Education Development Center for the Center for the Study and Prevention of Injuries, Violence, and Suicide. And clearly, I'm sure that when you say healthy, you mean healthy and safe. And so we are very supportive of all of the activities that are happening. And when I look at the topic areas, it's very exciting to see that probably over half of them could involve safety issues as well as, and I obviously haven't read them all, so I don't know if they already do that. I know that some do. What I'm wondering about is, I think that the federal government is working very hard to do lots of interagency groups, which I applaud them because we want that to happen in the states as well, and that's beginning to happen. But much of the funding that comes down is funded in silos, and it, obviously it would take a huge change how to change that, but I think in some ways that funding has to be guarded or guided to this interagency collaboration so that we're all addressing health risk factors and protective factors that affect each of the different diseases or injuries. And so I'm not sure exactly how that could happen, but that would be a challenge that I would ask you about, is how can we get all the people on the ground to have the resources to then do that cross-fertilization and working together? Thanks.
Thank you for your question. I can start with that one. We absolutely agree with you that the more collaboration on the ground, the more merging of funding streams, the more planning at the community level, the better off we're going to be as a country. I think we've started with the Affordable Care Act funding through the Prevention Fund, which is new funding that's very community-based. We have communities putting prevention to work efforts that are funded by the CDC, new community transformation grants that are part of the Prevention Fund moving forward. So that's a very exciting, very tangible part of the Affordable Care Act, and hopefully we'll see much more interdisciplinary collaboration funded by those efforts in the future.
I'm Dr. Vernon Daly, and I'm the president of the Eureka Center for Disease Prevention and Health Promotion. It's an organization 20 years old, and as its name suggests, we focused from the onset on how we can prevent disease and promote wellness. We have done a lot of community projects with this, and I had the pleasure of going not only statewide, but in the national arena, and served for 3 years at the Center for Disease Control to help to put the information out. Let me just say why I'm saying this. I admire so greatly what you've done. And not only you as this group, but I have followed the work of healthy people for the last 25 years, and I think it's a marvelous thing. What I'm troubled about, and maybe you can help me with this, the disease entity, the impact of it we're seeing is in the community. Question is, how do we reach the community? That was the focus and remains the focus of what we are trying to do. And as we look around, and you probably may have done this too, we find that we have a system that is excellent in intervention, intervening after the fact, but extremely deficient in trying to do anything to prevent the fact from happening. I must point out, unless we change that and prevent what we can, there is no way we're going to make a serious change in the outcomes. There will always be too much pathology coming down the road. And we can definitely change that. I would like to know if there's any focus on how we can do this. We look at the intervention system, we have nice hospitals, clinics, all kind of healing centers. Can anybody help me to find a single disease prevention and health promotion center in your community? That is what we're focused on. And I'd like to tell you that at this point, after 20 years, we have created a model that we've used extensively and successfully. I'm just in the process now of sharing it with all of us. I'll be happy to share it with you too, because I'd like you to look at it and give us your feedback and your input. All I need from you is just an email, and I have it right now on a PowerPoint presentation. I can't afford the rest of it as yet. I'll send it to you. I think that together we must realize in each community what we need right now is a disease prevention center. We're serving a huge portion of our population through the emergency room. Very inadequate care. And now, where can someone go to find help to remain well? We must now create the infrastructure for prevention. If we do that, together with all the fine things we have, and then make a marriage of these together, we can prevent just about, well, our own figures say, the national figures say we can prevent 75% of the debilitating illnesses that we see. I believe it's higher than that, but I'll go for 50%.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Dean Room, do you want to try that one?
First of all, you make a terrific point about community. How many of you have neighbors that have said, when you tell them what you did, I could never do what you do? How many of you have ever had that happen? Put your hands up. Come on, put your hands up. Okay, here's the truth that 2020 lays out, is that as long as people believe that, as long as they believe that the role of improving the health of the public and preventing illness and disease belongs to us, they don't need to take any responsibility. They can always believe that you'll be there to protect them. And I think 2020 really does invite us to think about the communities that are out there. And you were absolutely right. Our schools of public health are housed in places where there's extraordinary disparity. Well, the fact of the matter is, if we enter into those communities with answers rather than with what's laid out in 2020 that frames things in terms of questions and respect and acknowledging the strength of the community as our beginning position, we're going to fail unless we adopt that. And you know, the person who taught us that is Regina Benjamin, our Surgeon General, who's seated right here in the front. And physical activity, anybody read about the physical activity part of the report? Okay. One of the things they tell us is that standing up, stand up, everybody stand up. There's a person in front of you that you haven't met and a person behind you that you haven't met who's a member of the public health community who's about transforming the world. There's a director of the American Public Health Association seated in the second row. We have folks from NACHO, ASTO. We have students who are looking for jobs from NACHO and ASTO. Take 2 seconds, introduce one another, and be a community about prevention. Introduce yourselves.
Yep.
Okay. I am told that that's the sound that everybody at those committee meetings hope to hear. You sound excited. You sound hopeful. And I think you sound thankful. Any of you live in communities? Okay. There's something called a county health department. And those folks need your help, need your guidance, need your time, and need your expertise. And that's another way to respond. Right now, I'd like for you to respond by thanking this first panel of presenters, wildly abandoned. And if you feel like standing up again, feel free to do so. Okay, you can head on back. So the second part of the panel is you look at these things and say, okay, now what do we do? How do we make this real? What are the steps that we need to take? And so we've tried to put together a panel of people that are extraordinarily gifted in thinking broadly, in thinking about 2020. I'm always imagining, wasn't that perfect vision? So I guess now we have 2020 as our perfect vision and our perfect health. And as President Knapp said to me, he said, you know, our university will be celebrating its 100th birthday in 2021, so that incoming class is going to be healthier than ever before. Which we're very excited about. But at this point, what we'd like to do is introduce the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Health, Disease, Prevention, and Health Promotion. Rear Admiral Slade Sawyer is responsible for strengthening the disease prevention and health promotion priorities of the department within a collaborative framework of HHS agencies. Rear Admiral Slade Sawyer leads the Office of Disease Prevention and Health Promotion in coordinating three key initiatives for HHS. She's just responsible for Healthy People 2020, the Dietary Guidelines for Americans, and the Physical Activity Guidelines for Americans. Please give a warm welcome to Rear Admiral Penelope Slade Sawyer.